In this video, we're going to look at a binary distillation problem in which we have some specific circumstances. One being that we have a total boil-up occurring, so we have no bottoms product. We do have a distillate, but we have no reflux. So let's take a look at this problem and work through it together. So we have acetone being separated from ethanol. We're given feed information, and we're told that the feed is at the fourth stage from the top, so this may or may not be the optimal location. We're told instead of the reflux, we have a pure saturated liquid acetone that's entering the column. So this would be synonymous with maybe like open steam heating if we had a system that included water and we didn't want to use a boiler. The column's operating at steady state, the bottom's shut off. And so we're told that everything that goes into the boiler is being boiled up into the column. And we're asked to determine the distillate composition, the composition of a liquid sample if it was pulled from the reboiler, and the optimal feed stage. So let's start with labeling our diagram with known information. So I've labeled my column. We're going to assume constant molar overflow for our distillation. So the first place to start would be an overall material balance for our column. So we know whatever goes in must come out. So we have a feed plus a pure stream of acetone entering the top. And this is only coming out from our distillate product. We're given information for these values. So we could go ahead and plug that in. And right away, we could see what our distillate composition is going to be. An acetone balance can be written as such. So we could go ahead and plug in information we know for this. And we see we have one unknown. We can solve for our distillate composition, and we get 0.87. So let's go back to the problem statement. We've determined the distillate composition as 0.87. The second part of this question asks that if we took a sample of liquid from the reboiler, what that composition would be. So to do that, we would want to determine what the operating conditions for our top and bottom sections of our column would be. So we could label this as our top section and this as our bottom section, or the rectifying and stripping sections. And we could start doing material balances on these sections to determine the operating lines that we would use in a McCabe-Thiele analysis. So let's determine the area that we're interested in for doing our material balance, and we'll look at the top section first. If we draw a box around that area and write out our material balances for our top section, our overall balance would look like the following, where we have C entering, plus we'd have some vapor coming up our column, which we'll designate as V. We would have D leaving, and some kind of liquid also going down our column, therefore leaving the top section. So this would be our overall balance. We could also write a component balance. And if I do this in terms of mole fractions for our more volatile component acetone, I could write it as such. Now we could rearrange the component balance into our more familiar form of our operating lines that we use for our McCabe-Thiele analysis. So when we do it in terms of Y, we get the following equation. And you'll notice I made a mistake in the component balance. Here I wrote XD times our distillate because I'm so used to using a condenser that we're usually talking about a liquid mole fraction. In this case, we have vapor coming out of the column and it's not being condensed. So really, this should be Y, and we should also use that in our component balance. So this is our operating line for the top part of our column. Now there's a couple things to distinguish about our specific operating conditions. One, our component of acetone in our stream labeled C is saturated liquid and told that it's pure acetone. So our mole fraction is 1. Furthermore, because it's a saturated liquid, we could say that C is just equal to L. That being said, we also know that V must therefore be equal to D. So we could use this information back into our equation and replace some of those variables. So I've now written in a simplified form where we still have the slope being L over V as usual, and our intercept is the distillate composition minus our slope. This means we have a solution at X equals 1 of Y equaling our distillate composition. So now we have an intercept on the right side of our McCabe-Thiele diagram. We also know what L and V are since we have already done the material balance to solve for C and D. So we said that L was equal to 50 kilomoles per hour and D we solved to be 150. So we could place this into our operating line equation and get an equation that we could then plot on our diagram. So this becomes our equation. So now we have an equation that we can plot on our McCabe-Thiele diagram, which is shown here. We know our slope and we know our intercept. If we were looking for our y-intercept at x equals 0, We have y equaling 0.54, so this becomes our top operating line. We could also plot our feed line. We're told that we have a saturated vapor at composition of 0.8, so we go to the x equals y line at 0.8 and draw a horizontal line for a saturated vapor all the way across. So now we have our top operating line, we have our feed operating line. So what's our bottom operating line? Well, if we follow the same general rule where we would take the intercept of our feed in our top section and draw down to our bottom's composition, it doesn't matter where it is here, it has to follow the x equal y line. Now the other thing to keep in mind is that for our bottom section we have total reboil. So everything is going back into the column, and therefore the slope of that operating line is 1 and follows our x equals y line anyway. So this is our bottom operating line. We'll go ahead and show that just to double check, but if we write this as our V-bar and L-bar, our standard nomenclature that we typically have used, we could do an overall balance for our bottom section, so say something like this, and we know that using CMO that L-bar here is going down and V-bar is leaving. Typically we would have some bottoms product B, but in this case we do not. So we'd write our overall balance as L bar equals V bar. Our component balance would just be L bar X equals V bar Y, since we're not writing for our bottom stream. So in this case, X must equal Y, and as we just showed, that's the operating line on the McCabe-Thiele diagram. So we start at our top distillate composition, which is going to be the end point of our operating line. So in this case, we don't care about that 45 degree line. And we draw a stage over. And usually we would go down to the bottoms because that's where the switch is. But the feed stage isn't on 1. So we continue on our rectifying line, or the top operating line, until we count off 4 stages. So that's 2, that'd be 3. In our fourth stage, we would go ahead and make that cross at our fourth stage down to our bottoms, and then continue from our bottom operating line. We're told we have 6 stages. So that would be our fifth, and our last stage would be right there. So again, our first stage, we continued on our second, third, and at the fourth, since that is where we're told the feed is, we make the transfer from the rectifying line down to the stripping line. We continue a fifth stage and a sixth stage. Since we have no condenser and no reboiler, no partial reboiler, we do not include those as our equilibrium stages. So in this case, we have our 6 stages as specified. And using this 6-stage distillation column, we get a bottoms around 0.02. Now the other thing you'll notice is that our feed line intersects our lines at stage 1. So our optimal feed stage technically would be stage 1. And remember, the definition for our optimal feed stage is where we would minimize the amount of stages in our system. So you can imagine if we did that, what it would look like. Stage 1 was our optimal feed location. We would make that switch and we would start drawing our stages down all the way to the bottom to get that same composition. So here you see that it would only take us 4 stages in our column to achieve the same separation if we fed the vapor at stage 1. So hopefully this gives you an idea on how to write the balances for a column regardless of the type of conditions you're given. And you can see that if a feed doesn't enter a column at its optimal position, you may have to have more stages than necessary to achieve the same separation.